hearts awaken. Our God is moving, forever changing us. There is a trembling, there is revival, the sound of worship, so great and glorious.
Good morning, South Church of Nazarene. Welcome to our Sunday morning. Today is Palm Sunday. We are so excited that you are here to worship with us, and it's hard to believe that next week is Easter already, and we are here worshiping with you guys online this morning, and we are so excited that you are here with us. If you would, please go online to our website at southnaz.org, and when you go there, you can fill out our Connect cards, you can fill out our online giving, you can pull up the bulletin and Pastor Brad's notes, all those different things, so make sure that you do that and get in connection with that. We also want to make sure that you remember that if you have not signed up for the Remind app to sign up, there's instructions on your screen, so please do that so we can communicate to you in that way. And if you have not downloaded the South Naz app, please download that, and it's very easy to use to navigate on it. You can do all the different things that you do on the website. You can go to Connect Cards, online giving, all that. It's a real easy way to do that. So make sure that you fill it out with us this morning so we can keep connected with you guys during this uncertainty. This week is Easter week, and we are so excited for this Easter week. We understand it's going to look totally different than what we have been experiencing for all many years and things, but we are doing something this year that's going to be really excited, and your pastoral staff is excited to do this. We are going to be starting a kind of an Easter series called More Than We Can Imagine. This is going to start on Monday morning at 10 a.m., so you're going to want to make sure that you tune in to our YouTube or on Facebook Live or to our website. We will have all these options for this, so please make sure that you look at that. It's going to be at 10 o'clock on Monday morning, Tuesday morning, Wednesday morning, Thursday morning, and then Friday morning. And then on Friday night, we are still going to have our Good Friday service. It is going to be at 7 p.m. It is going to be live, so we are excited for that and excited for you to join us. So please join us with your family, and we just look forward to worshiping with you today. So please continue to worship with us this morning.
Happy Palm Sunday, everyone. Today, we remember the day, what the Bible calls the triumphal entry. Jesus rides into the city and the people shout, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And they praise him and want to crown him as king. We also know that that's not how the rest of the week went. But right now, let's praise God together, shouting Hosanna as we praise the one who saves.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Find strength to face the day, and in your presence all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day.
God. The people shouted Hosanna, asking him to come set up his kingship. And as we celebrate Holy Week, the week between Palm Sunday and Easter, we watch events unfold that show us that he was not bringing the kingship that they were asking for. And even today, as we sing together, King of Heaven, Jesus, let your kingdom come here and build it among us, we need to ask ourselves if we are asking him to bring a kingdom that we want in our own way and understanding, or if we are willing to follow him into his kingdom. And I am praying for his revelation and guidance and a clean heart to follow him where he leads and not where I want to walk.
Jesus, let your kingdom come here. Let your will be done here in us. Jesus, there is no one greater. You alone are Savior. Show the world your love. King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come. Oh, King of heaven, rise up. Who can stand against us? You are strong to save in your might.
Our hearts to warn you, that every eye would
let your glory reign, shining like the day, King of heaven come. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes will not perish, they shall have eternal life. I shall hold to the cross. I shall
This morning, we are going to be talking with Pastor Brad about the betrayal of Judas. So this morning, our scripture is found in Matthew 26, 6 through 16. And I would love for you to follow along with me this morning as I read this scripture. It's going to be on your screen in front of you also. This is what the Word of God says. Meanwhile, Jesus was in Bethany at the home of Simon, a man who had previously had leprosy. While he was eating, a woman came in with a beautiful alabaster jar of expensive perfume and poured it over his head. The disciples were indignant when they saw this. "What a waste," they said. "It could have been sold for a high price and the money given to the poor." But Jesus, aware of this, replied, "Why criticize this woman for doing such a good thing to me? You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. She has poured this perfume on me to prepare my body for burial. I tell you the truth, wherever the good news is preached throughout the world, this woman's deed will be remembered and discussed. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples, went to the leading priest and asked, "How much will you pay me to betray Jesus to you?" And they gave him 30 pieces of silver. From that time on, Judas began looking for an opportunity to betray Jesus.
Judas, what do we think of when we hear this man's name? We think or label him as betrayer, selfish, ruthless, a hardened heart, a liar, coward, cheapskate, and a sneak. All labels that disgust us to think about. And we want to shake our heads when we hear his name. It also makes our hearts sad to think about the fate of this man and the choices that he would go on to make. But as I read this story, I began to think of the labels he had before all of this. A disciple of Jesus, a student, friend of the disciples, follower of God, and a witness of the many miracles of Jesus. Now, there's not nearly as many cheerful labels that he would be remembered for. So what happened to the Judas that was called by Jesus to come and follow him just like all the rest of the disciples? Now, looking through the scriptures, we don't find any other places where Judas is mentioned until we read about Judas agreeing to betray Jesus. All of a sudden, this man that we've known nothing about but have known was following Jesus all along has agreed to hand over the one person who called him and asked him to follow him. We first hear about Judas right after Jesus was anointed by the sinful woman. Jesus was just shown an outpouring of love towards him when the woman came to anoint his feet. And now, a man who had followed him and learned from him was going to be the one to show him hate. The even harder piece, Judas was the one who went to the chief priests. They didn't seek him out and apply pressure on him. The betrayal was his idea. It's difficult to imagine what was going on inside of Judas's head the day that he had met with the chief priests. I want to think and imagine that he wasn't sleeping well that night, the same night that Jesus was pouring his heart out and praying in the garden. The three disciples had no issue falling asleep, but I began to wonder, what about Judas? Was he tossing and turning, wondering what Jesus may do to him, fearful of Jesus' power and what he could do? Was he scared about what the other disciples thought about him? Did he begin to doubt his choice to meet with the chief priests? Did Jesus know the plan to come and arrest him in the garden? What would Jesus do to him? Was he thinking about what Jesus had said to him, said about him at the Last Supper? Jesus said, "But woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Maybe those words stung deep into his heart. But I think in all honesty, Judas slept great that night. He wasn't worried at all. Maybe he was excited for the choice that he had made, his heart racing as that tonight was going to be the night. It would be the perfect place. Jesus praying in the garden alone, the three disciples constantly falling asleep. Maybe he was thinking and dreaming about what he would do with the money once he received it. What special item he would go and buy with those 30 pieces of silver. He couldn't wait to see the looks on the chief priests' faces when he had Jesus arrested. Or maybe how the chief priests would certainly praise him for turning in the man who was preaching and teaching. He would be a hero. And all would remember him for turning in this man. But this wouldn't be the case for Judas. Our kids on Wednesday night are learning about humility. And on Wednesday, we taught about Jesus praying in the garden and Judas coming to betray Jesus. Jesus came and turned our world upside down by his teachings and showing us how to be humble. So this balloon this morning represents Judas. Judas was following Jesus and was obedient to his teachings, which allowed him to move freely. Now, this isn't going to be moving freely, otherwise I will lose my balloon and I will lose my object lesson. But this balloon is floating freely. I don't have to move it. It is freely floating by itself. And the same thing was happening with Judas. Judas was freely following and obeying God. But then something inside of Judas changed. He began to disagree with Jesus and he began to despise him. So I'm going to add some magnets and we're going to see what's going to happen to my balloon. It's starting to sink a little bit. He didn't want to do all the things that Jesus was asking him to do. He began to question all of the teachings, all of the things that Jesus was asking him to do. And maybe he began to think, I don't really want to go and do those things, Jesus. Why are you making me do all of these things? So I'm going to add another weight to my balloon. Whoop. But we can see as I add more and more weights to my balloon, it begins to sink more and more as that one fell off. So, he began to overhear the chief priests, and he began to trust what they were saying and not the words of Jesus. He then decides to take matters into his own hands and see how he could benefit from having Jesus arrested himself. Let me see if I can add one more so we can actually get it to stay down. And they keep falling off. There we go. Each time, it was weighing Judas down more and more, not allowing Jesus to work in him and change him. He was so focused on what he wanted and how he could benefit that he lost sight of what Jesus was wanting him to do. And he may have even lost sight of what was happening to him. It was weighing him down. Judas wasn't freed from his selfishness. But we can be, unlike Judas, when we ask for forgiveness and when we admit of the things that are weighing us down, when we decide that we're not going to go the way that we want to, we're going to follow God and be obedient to him, we can then move freely, unlike Judas, move freely with God and be obedient to his calling and what he wants for our lives.
Good morning, South Church family. We are gathered here today to pray together. As we gather in our homes and gather online, we want to spend some time in prayer. And let me remind you of a passage of scripture that caught my attention today. I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. I will boast only in the Lord. Let all who are helpless take heart. Come and let us tell of the Lord's greatness and let us exalt his name together. Those who look to him in time of help will have radiant joy. No shadow of shame will darken their faces. In my depression, the psalmist writes, I prayed and the Lord listened and he saved me from all of my troubles. Well, that passage of scripture has more weight in it in our minds today as we wrestle with this virus and the continuing isolation and all the things that are part of that. And no doubt that there are many people who are struggling with feelings of depression and feelings of despair and feelings of anxiety and worry and concern. Many of those are very founded, but some of those kind of run rampant in these kind of times. So we want to pray together for God's peace in the midst of that, that we would have radiant joy in spite of the circumstances that we face. Well, let me remind you of a few prayer requests that we need to remember to pray for today. Steve Reeder sent me a text this week and asked me to pray for his friend Don. Is a grandpa,
And his granddaughter was stillborn this week, and we want to pray that God would bless this family during this time as they grieve and as they go through a difficult time, a lot of questions and a lot of brokenness as we walk through something like that. We also want to pray for our state, especially as our governor has now announced that there will be no more face-to-face school teaching this year, and everything is going to be online, just like we are experiencing together. And we want to pray for our teachers, for their creativity and for the resources and for the technology and all the things that will make that have value and be more than just going through the motions, but our students will be able to learn. And I know that there's great ways that they can do that, and we want to pray for our teachers especially. We also want to pray for people who are on the front line, whether it's doctors or nurses or people who are cleaning the hospitals and the care centers. It's a grocery worker and the guy at the gas station and all the people that make our society function, even in the midst of our isolation. And many of them had no idea that they would be front line in the midst of all these things that we are going through. And we want to pray for them today and that God would bless them and help them and give them the strength that they need. Some of them are pulling some long shifts, and we want to pray for them today. And then we also want to pray for those who are sick, people who have lost someone they love, and we want to ask that God would touch and bless and encourage them. And speaking of that, we want to pray for Lynn Brown's family. Lynn passed away this last week, and the service was on Friday, and we want to pray for Lynn's family and all the people that are part of that. Let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you because you are our source. We come to you because you are the God who invites us to bring our needs and our concerns to you. And you promise us that as we focus our attention not just on our needs, but on who you are, we will find joy and hope and peace in the midst of our circumstances. Father, we pray for Steve's friend Don, and their family and all the people that are connected to that story, and for this little life that seemed to have a beginning and yet was snuffed out so early and so young. Father, we pray that you will bless this family during this time, and as they walk through the grief that's associated with hopes that have been dashed, Father, I pray that you will replace that with your hope and your strength and your mercy in their lives today. And Father, we pray for our teachers today, and they have just received news over the last few days that they will be asked to teach in ways that they've never been taught or trained how to do before. Father, we pray for our education system and all the things that need to come in place to make that happen, whether it is technology and the internet, or it's the ability for teachers to try to figure out how to teach a child a lesson that is hard to teach in person, let alone on the internet. And Father, we just pray for creativity and wisdom and help for all those who are going to be asked to do things that are beyond their current abilities or maybe even capacity. And Father, we pray that you'll meet their needs today. Father, we think about the guard that has been deployed here in Michigan. We pray that you'll bless those soldiers as they serve our nation and try to help us as we work through this crisis together, and especially working through the state of Michigan. And Father, there are so many people who are sick from this virus, and many people who are sick just because that's the normal everyday happening that we survive in this world. Lord, we pray that you'll give a peace and comfort and healing to all those who are walking through those times together. And Father, for those who are grieving, like the Brown family, Father, and many others, we pray that you will touch and encourage and lift them up. Help us to grieve as folks who have a promise that a man who followed the heart of God like Lynn Brown is in the presence of Christ today. And Lord, we celebrate that, and we pray for Lynn's family as they walk through this time. And we thank you for your promise to be our strength in the midst of every circumstance we face. Now, Father, we pray that you will take this gathering together through the internet today, and that you will make it something more than just a scheduled thing on our calendar. You will make it an encounter with your Spirit. You will help us to engage and to listen as if your Spirit longs to speak to us, because we believe you do. Your word tells us that you want to do surgery on the parts of our heart that need to be mended, that need to be strengthened and restored, and maybe even resurrected. So, Father, we pray that you will help us to hear your words for us today. Be honored in all that's been said so far as we think about what Gretchen shared with us and the scriptures that Travis read and the music that we have celebrated with. May we experience your voice in all those things. And Father, we thank you for your promise to be with us in the midst of that. In the strong name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
It is my victory.
Well, South Nash family, I want to thank you for your generosity during this time. We have been challenged in ways that we never expected before, and the reality is giving is much, much different when we are giving online, and I just want to invite you to be a part of what we're doing. Worship God by celebrating His generosity to you, by being generous back towards His kingdom. And during these days, we have all kinds of things that are still happening as a church, whether it is salaries that we pay or even the utility bills and all the things that are part of what's happening here, and the capacity to do what we're doing right now, this internet interaction. We just ask you to continue to support what's happening at your church, not as just a way to participate in the increased costs that are going on, but also a way to worship. And let's just pray for our offering now. Father, we thank you that as we give, whether it's a paper check that we mail in or giving online, we ask that you will help us to experience the joy of generosity. Lord, may you help us to remember that everything that we have belongs to you, and that you are the one who is providing for us in this difficult time. You're providing for us the resources that we need. You're providing for us the continuing presence of your Spirit as we walk through this difficult time. And Father, we want to respond to your generosity to us by being generous to your kingdom. So Father, I pray that you will take what we give, that you will multiply it to meet the needs. And Father, we thank you that you are working at meeting the needs of our congregation as well. And Father, give us opportunities to come alongside folks as is appropriate. And Lord, we just thank you for a chance to do that. Be honored as we give in this moment. In Jesus' name, amen.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Could we with thee
by trade to write the law of God. saints and angels song.
The story of Judas is far more complicated than we typically make it. In fact, most of the time we think about it something like this. A bad guy did a bad thing. In fact, the worst thing ever. In Scripture, they're often gospel writers often refer to Judas as the devil. Listen to what it says in John chapter 6, verse 71. Then Jesus said, "I chose the 12 of you, but one is the devil." He was speaking of Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, one of the 12 who would later betray him. And then in the same passage of Scripture, in the same book of the Bible, in John chapter 12, we read these words. But Judas Iscariot, the disciple who would betray Jesus, said about the lady bringing the perfume, Mary bringing the perfume to Jesus' feet, "That perfume was worth a year's wages. It should have been sold and the money given to the poor." Not that he cared for the poor, John says, because he was a thief, and since he was in charge of the disciples' money, he often stole for himself. Now, both of those passages of Scripture were written after the resurrection. In other words, they were written after Judas had done the deed of betraying Christ to the religious leaders and had participated in what we look back on now in history as one of the most evil events of all human history. But the Bible also paints a picture about Judas as with a different light. In fact, while Judas was with them and participating in the story with the disciples, the Bible describes the word as he was trusted. On the night of the Last Supper, the disciples assumed that Judas was leaving not to take care of this deed of betrayal, but rather something else. They thought Jesus was telling Judas to go and pay the bill for the food that they had been eating. And so Judas went out into the night, it says in John chapter 13. And as wicked as we know Judas to be, at some point, he was trusted. He was, while perhaps less accepted maybe than some of the others, he had a position in Jesus' ministry. In fact, the prophets talk about the betrayer like this. In Psalm 41, it says, "Even my best friend, the one I trusted completely, the one who shared my food, has turned against me." Well, the prophets didn't have the hindsight that the disciples had when they were writing the Gospels and remembering all the events that happened there. But some say that Judas, although he was considered wrong and evil and all those things, was not that different than Peter. In fact, they had a lot of things in common. We're going to look at some of those things in common today. Peter was known as a borderline zealot who sometimes wanted Jesus to overthrow the Roman government. He was far more interested in the power of the Messiah than he was in the servant heart of the Messiah. And in fact, in Matthew chapter 16, Peter tries to change Jesus' plan. Jesus is saying to his disciples, "I'm going to go to Jerusalem, I'm going to be crucified, I'm going to die. It's all part of the plan." And Peter, in Matthew 16, takes Jesus aside and says to Jesus, "That's not how it's going to happen." No, and the Bible actually uses the word Peter rebuked Jesus for talking about his death, to which Jesus calls Peter's plans demonic. So here we have Peter, who Jesus is saying is demonic, or at least his plans are demonic, and Judas, who clearly was demonic as we look at all the things that were part of that. They both had their own agenda when it comes to Jesus. Perhaps it was their link to their need to be in the limelight, or their plan to know the kingdom of God, when it would come, how it would come, and what it would look like when it came. They all had their own ideas about that. In fact, James and John had some pretty odd ideas about that as well. But Peter and Judas both wanted their way and their agenda. Judas excuse me, Judas didn't sit passively on the sidelines. When it came to this, the religious leaders and the actions that were part of that, he was all in. He was absolutely all in what he was doing. And then when Jesus comes to Judas at the Last Supper and says, I'm going to dip the bread with you, and whoever I dip the bread with, that's the one who's going to betray me. And he comes and he does that with Judas, even whispers in his ear. Judas hangs in there for what he had planned to do. As Gretchen talked to us earlier, he was willing to do whatever it takes, and even to say this phrase, maybe not out loud, but the end justifies the means. I'm not so sure that Judas wanted Jesus dead. I think Judas thought Jesus' arrest would bring the kingdom the way he was looking for the kingdom to be brought, with force and power and overthrowing the people that are around them. And even though Jesus had told his disciples that this was coming, they had heard it, but they never really understood it. Peter was in with a sword, and Judas was in with a kiss. John Wesley, one of the founding people of our theology and helping us to understand what it means to follow God with our whole heart, said these words. Jesus answered in his ear, so careful as not to offend, if that would be possible with Judas himself, the dipped bread which he took up while he was speaking. And he gave it to Judas. And probably the other disciples, according to John Wesley, thought Judas was pleased at being chosen. But even at the insistence of the Lord's tenderness could not move him, then Wesley says, that's when Satan took full possession. Whatever you do, he says, do quickly. This is not a permission, much less than a command. It is only if he had said that you're determined to do it, then go ahead and do what you're determined to do. Later, Judas meets Jesus in the garden and IDs Jesus with a kiss. While thinking like Peter, this was going to be a showdown. And Jesus would be forced to rise up and the kingdom of God would reign and my plan will be set in motion. And then when Peter takes the sword and whacks the guy's ear off, that's just a bonus. But Jesus puts the brakes on it all. He doesn't, not only does he not resist, he heals the ear of Peter's victim and he allows them to escort him away. Peter, the only one to follow Jesus, later abandons Jesus' plan when he denies that he even knows him. And Judas, his frustration is shown when he throws the money back to the religious leaders. And then tragedy follows as Judas takes his own life in Matthew chapter 26 or 27. In a what have I done moment, he went all in, and Judas found himself on the wrong side. Charles Spurgeon, a great preacher back in many years ago, said these words, "What if I should be guilty of the same accused sin of Judas? I've been baptized in the name of the Lord. I'm a member of his visible church," he went on to say. "I sit at the communion table. All those are kisses from my lips. Am I sincere in them?" he asked. "If not, I am a traitor as well. Do I live in a world as carelessly as others do and yet make profession of being a follower of Jesus? Then I expose my faith to ridicule, and I lead men to speak evil of the holy name by which I am called. God forbid," Spurgeon says, "that I should be a high-soaring professor and preacher and then fall at the last into the lake of fire because I betrayed my master with a kiss." There's some truths in this comparison that I want us to wrestle with today. This comparison between Peter and Judas and Judas being seen as a traitor and all the things that are a part of that. And sometimes we put Judas in this place that he is so far different than anything we would ever have chosen that we don't evaluate our own heart in comparison to his. And I believe that every story that's listed in Scripture gives us an opportunity to compare our lives with the lives of those we read about. So let's take a moment and look at some of these truths that we're going to wrestle with. The first truth is this: are my words and my acts of service, are they at the command of my king, or are they based on my own agenda? In Matthew chapter 16, Peter's telling Jesus, no, you can't die on the cross. That's not how it's going to happen. He rebukes Jesus. His plan for Jesus' revelation of the Messiah was way different than Jesus' plan. And he had to wrestle with the fact that his agenda needed to be laid aside. Now, you know that I have had the opportunity over the course of years to go on many different mission trips around the world, literally around the world, many different countries from Africa to the Far East and many places in between. And one of the things that I had to learn about missions and work and witness and all that is that I cannot come to another place with my agenda to be a service to others. I need, when I go to another place in the world, to submit to the needs and the plans of the country I came to serve. That often meant that I mixed concrete on the ground, even though there was a mixer available. And that because that allowed more nationals to be a part of the project and more people to be a part of the work that we were doing. From driving to wiring to preaching and teaching, all of it is different in every place that I have been and far different from where I came. Perhaps the most difficult for me personally was when I was teaching in Cambodia. I was invited to come and teach a bunch of pastors on spiritual disciplines, and I was there teaching them. And one of the things that was expected of me was that I would take my shoes off at the door and leave them in the pile of shoes there at the door. Now, I don't like to walk around in my stocking feet. I don't even do that at home. I either wear my shoes or I go barefooted, but this stocking feet thing was weird, and I'm thinking to myself, I'm gonna get holes in my socks. This is ridiculous. Because I was preaching on a concrete floor in this place in Cambodia. But that's what I was asked to do. And sometimes I'm expected to do that at your house when I come and visit, and I see the pile of shoes by the floor, and I just think to myself, really? Do we have to do this? You're going to see my weird socks. I hope I don't have any holes in my socks. All those things that are part of that. But on top of that, we threw our shoes in a big pile. And when I came down to go outside to do something there after I had taught a little bit, I looked at the pile of shoes and I could not find my shoes anywhere. I looked in, and I have pretty big feet compared to Cambodians for sure, and I looked around and my big black shoes were absolutely nowhere. I was thinking, what am I going to do now? Until I saw my friend, Pastor Narit, walking by with my shoes on. I guess I have to learn what it means to set my plans aside, don't I? My plans of doing things, and apparently even my shoes, to be subject to the master's command. Peter and Judas wrestled with laying their agenda aside when it came to following Jesus. They had their ideas and their plans, and the question that we must wrestle with, just like Peter did, just like Judas did, just like I do on another part of the world, am I coming under the plans and authority of, under the control of the Master, or am I going my own way? The second thought is this: there are often things that are happening in Jesus' agenda that I don't understand. There are often things that Jesus has in mind that I don't get. I can't see. I don't know what's coming. I don't get how it's going to happen. I just don't understand it. For Judas, it was these words, perhaps, that rattled his cage when Jesus in Matthew chapter 5 says this: blessed are the meek, and blessed are the poor, and blessed are those who suffer. Because Judas was about being seen. He was about having money at the end of the month, and he was about honor. A passage that I have come to learn about more than once is found in Isaiah chapter 55. My ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. And in fact, if you were to go on, it says, so be still and know that I am God. I have found that to be true so many times in my life. When I've been asked to obey his plan and his leading, and I don't know for sure what he's up to, when he says, I want you to leave this place and go someplace else, I want you to adopt this boy, I want you to say yes to this adventure, and I want you to say no to something that I thought was a great idea. I need to understand that there are often things at play in Jesus' agenda that I don't understand, but I am still invited to trust who he is and what he's saying to me. And the third thought is this: repentance and pardon can realign our hearts. In John chapter 21, we have what I believe is one of the most beautiful passages of Scripture that is restoring the fallen back into a right relationship with God. Peter is restored back to his relationship with Jesus by Jesus asking three questions. Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? And Peter, do you love me? They weren't very creative questions, but they were pretty powerful questions. They got to the point of things that Jesus was asking Peter, do you love me enough to trust me, even in the midst of all that's going on? And the most significant for me in that is that Jesus asked the same number of times that Peter had denied him. And Peter was restored. Judas was not. In 1829, George Wilson was arrested for robbing mail trains and endangering the mail carrier. He was sentenced to die by hanging. But Wilson had powerful friends who convinced President Andrew Jackson to grant Wilson a reprieve from the hangman's noose. The president issued a pardon in June of 1830, but Wilson officially rejected the pardon in October of that same year. The case was then taken to the Supreme Court of all things, which ruled as this: a pardon is a dead to the validity of which is delivered is essential, and delivery is not complete without acceptance. It may then be rejected by the person to whom it is tendered, and if it be rejected, we have discovered no power in the court to force it on him. Wilson was then executed. So this is the truth of that story. A pardon isn't a pardon unless it's accepted. At least that's what the Supreme Court ruled. Now, I've also often wondered about this theoretical question. If Judas would have repented, would Jesus have forgiven him? Now, that grates against our understanding of Judas being a devil, right? That grates against our understanding of Judas doing the worst act in all of human history, betraying the Messiah, God who came to rescue all of humanity. When we think about what Judas did, we would say, no, that's impossible. That can't even begin to describe what would have happened. I imagine on the night that Jesus was arrested, two of the disciples failed him in a big way. Judas betrayed Jesus by selling his Lord for a bag of 30 pieces of silver. Peter denied him, even calling down curses on himself as he lied about being a follower of Jesus. I don't even know the man, Peter says. Both of them sinned greatly. Both of them felt great remorse after the fact. One of them, Peter, returned to Jesus and sought forgiveness. But Judas fled from God, and the Bible says he took his own life, committed suicide. Peter found forgiveness and went on to be the great leader of the church. Judas refused God's pardon and died a hopeless man, because a pardon that isn't accepted is no pardon at all. God offers each of us a pardon, according to Scripture, the chance to have our sins blotted out, washed out, even when we are, even our well-intentioned plans or acts of service that aren't led or directed by the Holy Spirit, like Peter and Judas, those acts can be forgiven as well. We can escape the death sentence that sin has placed on us. We can be forgiven, or we can ignore God's offer, pay the penalty for what we have done, because a pardon that isn't accepted is no pardon at all. But John the Apostle writes these words: if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In fact, just a little bit earlier in 1 John, when John wrote those words, he says, if we say that we haven't sinned, we're really calling God a liar, because all of us have crossed that line when it comes to our relationship with God. And God offers to each of us, and I believe would have offered to Judas the same had Judas turned towards Christ. God invites each of us to experience his forgiveness. So, let me pray with you, and then I want to pray a prayer. I'm going to read a prayer. I don't do that very often, but I want to read a prayer that Spurgeon, Charles Spurgeon, wrote when he was wrestling with this same idea. Let me read it to you as we close today. Lord, make me sincere and true. Preserve me from every false way. Never let me betray my Savior. I do love thee, Jesus, and though I often grieve you, I desire to be a faithful even unto death. Father, we pray that you will help us to not live by the agendas that we think ought to be happening in our world, but to surrender and submit our agendas to God, to you, Father, to lay down our to-do lists and our plans, and ask you, do these line up with your heart today? Is what I'm doing matching what you've invited me to do? Am I seeking your kingdom first? Father, I pray that you'll help us to not get off track, even by a step, that we would come to experience anything less than what you intended for us to know and experience. We ask you for forgiveness for those times where we have presumed that we know better than you. And Father, as we wrestle with this virus and all the things that are a part of that, Lord, help us to trust that you're at work even in the midst of difficult times. Help us to surrender our anxiety and our concern at the foot of the cross and know that even there you make some of the darkest things experience the brightest light. May you help us to experience that in our hearts as well as in our minds as we wrestle through this time together. In the strong name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Well, our worship team is going to lead us in another song, and then I'll come back and have a benediction for us.
Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Oh,
Well, it has been good to be with you today, church. And even though it's online, I can vision your faces as I look across the sanctuary. And I'm praying for you, and we are continuing to pray for you. And we want to encourage you to recognize that God is at work among us and even through us. Call somebody this week and let them know that you're thinking about them and praying for them as well. And find out if there's anything that you can do to walk alongside of them in these days as we wrestle with this virus isolation. Well, let me remind you of these words. That God can do in us more than we could ever imagine or even begin to ask as we allow His Spirit to work inside. Father, help us to lay our agenda at Your feet, to live by the agenda that You have given for us, to be salt and light, to be help and encouragement, to be hope for a world that is looking for a place to anchor their hope to. Lord, I pray that You will help us to reflect Your kingdom in all we do, not because we can pull it off by ourselves, but because as we imagine Your working in us, it is Your power and Your Spirit that gives us the ability to do all that You've called us to do. Help us to live in Your strength and in Your power, not our own. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.